accused in Sushant case, Riya Chakravarti being quizzed by the CBI. Pithani and Sushant staff also present. Bollywood drugs link on narcotics bureau's radar. Sources say allegations against Riya are just tip of the iceberg and the rot runs deeper. Top court rules, final year college exams have to be held. States under Disaster Management Act can postpone exams in lieu of COVID but require UGC approval. Mira Now stands with JEE, needs students in their fight to postpone the entrance exams. Call us or tweet us and we'll make the government hear your voice. Badriyar Highway blocked after a landslide in Chamoli. Srinagar Jammu Highway shut since 4 days after landslide. The chorus for postponing JEE and NEET exams has intensified. Six state governments, West Bengal, Punjab, Maharashtra, Rajasthan, Chhattisgarh and Jharkhand, have jointly filed a review plea in Supreme Court seeking cancellation of the entrance exams. The plea, moved by the cabinet ministers from these states, have cited the pandemic as a reason for seeking cancellation and sought a review of the earlier Supreme Court order which gave a nod for holding of these exams. Meanwhile, candidates of JEE and NEET from across the nation who are enrolled for the exams are still clueless as to how they are going to travel to exam centres amidst the pandemic. While in some states, public transport has resumed, in most states, students say that the public transportation is a big issue. Listening to some of the candidates living outside of the big cities, hoping that the government will hear their voices.
मुझे 13 सितंबर को नीट का एग्ज़ाम देना है और मेरा एग्ज़ाम सेंटर लखनऊ है और वो मेरे घर से 350 किलोमीटर दूर है, तो हमारी दिक्कत ये है कि हम वहाँ तक कैसे जाएंगे क्योंकि ट्रांसपोर्टेशन फैसिलिटी अभी अवेलेबल नहीं है, तो हम वहाँ तक कैसे पहुँचेंगे एग्ज़ाम सेंटर तक। और मई में एग्ज़ाम होना था तो हमने अपना सिलेबस कम्प्लीट कर लिया है, तो हमारी तैयारी परीक्षा के लिए है।
माई नेम है ऋतिक जैन एंड आई एम अ जूई एस्पिरेंट और मैं इस साल जेई की परीक्षा देने वाला हूँ। देखो, ऐसा है कि इस साल कोरोना में परीक्षा बिल्कुल नहीं होनी चाहिए क्योंकि जो मेरा जो घर है वो कंटेमिनेट जोन में है। पब्लिक ट्रांसपोर्ट यहाँ दूर दूर तक नहीं मिल रहा है और अगर पब्लिक ट्रांसपोर्ट मिल भी गया तो एक ही गाड़ी में 40 लोग बैठते हैं और उस गाड़ी के अंदर सोशल डिस्टेंसिंग फॉलो हो ही नहीं सकती है। और मेरे घर पर जो मेरा सेंटर है वो 60 किलोमीटर दूर है और उस सेंटर पर 500 से ज़्यादा बच्चे एक ही दिन में वो आने वाले हैं और साथ में उनके पेरेंट्स भी आएंगे, तो सोचो गवर्नमेंट की जो सोशल डिस्टेंसिंग है वो कैसे फॉलो होंगी उस सेंटर्स पर, वो पॉसिबल नहीं है। और अब तक जितने भी पेपर हुए हैं, चाहे आपका वो KCET हो गया हो, कॉमेट की हो गया हो, UP BEd हो गया हो या GSET हो गया हो, एक भी पेपर में अब तक सोशल डिस्टेंसिंग फॉलो हो ही नहीं है। और जो ऐसे बोलते हैं कि थर्मल स्क्रीनिंग करेंगे वो भी नहीं करते हैं, तो ये पॉसिबल ही नहीं है कि इस वक्त कोरोना काल में परीक्षा कराई जाए। और ऊपर से देखो, ऐसा है कि एक सबसे बड़ा मुद्दा ये भी है कि अगर किसी को कोरोना किसी बच्चे को हो गया तो उसका खर्चा कौन उठाएगा, क्योंकि आप जानते हो कि आप नाना बाटी चले जाओ, बैजान चले जाओ, यहाँ पे 25-25 लाख का बिल आता है, तो अब हर कोई तो दे नहीं पाता 25-25 लाख का बिल। तो इस चीज़ को समझना पड़ेगा गवर्नमेंट को कि अगर हम एक तो महीने के लिए टाल सकते हैं परीक्षा, तो हम क्यों नहीं टालें। हम ऐसा बोल रहे हैं कि एक साल बच्चों का खराब हो जाएगा, तो ये बात बिल्कुल सही नहीं है कि एक साल ये खराब हो जाएगा, तो जान है मेरे हिसाब से यही होता है।
Hello, I am Sayan Panja. I am from West Bengal and mainly from Devipur, Purva Bardhaman, and I am preparing for NEET UG 2020 and My center is 71 kilometer from my house, and it is very difficult for me in this time to travel about 70 kilometer, and the services like the trains are not available right now. So it's very difficult for me to afford that kind of things, the like cars in right now, and I am facing problem, and if they can postpone it, it will be very helpful for me.
My name is Sanat Alok, and I live in Bihar in Arariya district, and my center is 450 kilometers far from my home. So, and I can't get any personal vehicle since I don't have it. So the cab is charging a lot of money. The cab asked for 6,000 to 7,000 rupees for just one way, and it's too hard for me. And also my father is a patient of diabetes and hypertension, and me too, I'm a patient of sinus tachycardia, which means my heartbeat is 120 beat per minute. Generally it is 72 beat per minute. So wearing mask for 3 hours is not possible for me. So if I go and give the exam, what happens to my father, and how can I risk the life of even mine and my father? Why it is supposed to be? Why the government is so rigid and not even thinking about us?
My name is Shivraj. I am from Meerut, and my center is 48 kilometers away. It is located on the outskirts of the city, so it is possible to reach there only by personal vehicle. Although I have a personal vehicle, but I don't want to risk my parents' life because they are 55 plus. The cab owners are charging 4 to 5 times the actual price, and that too only for one way. No one is ready to pick us up because they fear of getting infected.
I live in outskirts of Raji, that is in Ratu, and my exam center is टुपुदाना, विच इज अप्रॉक्सीमेटली अबाउट 40 किलोमीटर्स दूर. अब यह रांची में कोई भी पब्लिक ट्रांसपोर्ट अभी अवेलेबल नहीं है, तो क्या कोई बता सकता है कि आखिर हम स्टूडेंट्स जो है इतने दूर 40 किलोमीटर कैसे जाएंगे अपने एग्जाम सेंटर में? क्या कोई हमें पब्लिक ट्रांसपोर्ट यहाँ अवेल करा सकता है? जो यहाँ की गवर्नमेंट भी यहाँ तक अभी तक पब्लिक ट्रांसपोर्ट अवेलेबल नहीं करा पाई है. और पेपर में आज दिया हुआ था कि NDA के लिए कुछ पब्लिक व्हीकल्स अवेलेबल होगा, लेकिन देर इज नो कोई इंतजाम नहीं किया जा रहा जेई और नीट एस्पिरेंट के लिए कि हाँ कोई भी पब्लिक ट्रांसपोर्ट अवेलेबल नहीं है, और मेरे पास अपना पर्सनल व्हीकल भी नहीं है. तो अब कोई मुझे बताए कि मैं अपना एग्जाम सेंटर कैसे जाऊंगा, और मेरे पास इतना मनी भी नहीं है कि मैं अफोर्ड करूं और एक पर्सनल कैब बुक कर लूं और जिसके थ्रू मैं वहां एग्जाम सेंटर जाऊं. और अगर मैं बुक करके जाता भी हूं तो मुझे छोड़ने के लिए तैयार है वहां, लेकिन वापस लाने के लिए तैयार नहीं है. वो बोलता है कि अगर तुम्हें कोरोना हो गया तो फिर मुझे भी कोरोना हो जाएगा, इसलिए मैं तुम्हें लाऊंगा नहीं, मैं तुम्हें वहां छोड़ दूंगा. अब ऐसे मैं वहां से कैसे वापस आऊंगा? क्या पैदल चल के आऊंगा? ये तो कोई सोल्यूशन ही ना हुआ. अब मैं गवर्नमेंट से पूछना चाहता हूँ कि मैं आखिर एग्जाम सेंटर कैसे पहुँचूंगा?
We believe the preparations for the entrance exams have not factored in the concerns of lakhs of candidates currently in rural areas and smaller towns. Those who don't have the wherewithal to travel to the exam centers, join Mirror Now campaign on JEE NEET exams. We're asking students to raise their voices, so you can call us and tweet to us by raising your voice and the transport challenges you're facing, and we'll ensure your voice gets heard. Moving on now, verdict is out from the top court on the final year college exams. The Supreme Court has said that final exams must be held and students cannot be promoted without holding exams. But the court added that exams may be postponed in view of COVID, and the move will require an approval from the UGC.
Well, that's right. This is a verdict which is coming close on the heels of the earlier judgment of the Supreme Court, which was dated the 17th of August. That was pertaining to the NEET JEE exams. And we know today the opposition joint review plea has also now been filed challenging the original judgment dated the 17th of August in the NEET JEE exams. Presently, we are bringing to our viewers the Supreme Court ruling that has been delivered by a different bench composition headed by Honorable Justice Ashok Bhushan pertaining to the final year examinations of the UGC. And like you rightly mentioned, the Supreme Court said that promotion of students without exams entirely is something which cannot be made possible. The Supreme Court has also not gone ahead and quashed the UGC's notification which is permitting for the exams to be held. Our viewers will recall when this matter was being argued before Justice Ashok Bhushan's bench composition in the top court, it was the Honorable Supreme Court bench which had said that the fate of the students cannot be decided by the students themselves. It has to be decided by a statutory authority. So today there is this middle path that has been attempted at by the top court, where, like you rightly mentioned, the Supreme Court has also given the option to those states like Delhi and Maharashtra, which had gone ahead and postponed these examinations, to try their luck and knock on the doors of the UGC, saying as to how the situation in their respective regions is not conducive for the conducting of those exams. Furthermore, today's direction of the Supreme Court also says this, that the UGC now will have to consider the requests of these states in a favorable manner. So clearly some sort of a middle path has been attempted at by the top court, given the fact that perhaps the situation may not be same across the country. For example, in some regions, the situation may be more graver than in other areas. So the states who want a postponement of the UGC exams have to now get the nod from the UGC itself. The UGC has been directed to view the request of the states in a favorable manner. And furthermore, the Supreme Court categorically has said that promotion of the students without exams would not be viable.
Moving on now, in a big development, Riya Chakraborty is at the DRDO guest house and she is being questioned by the CBI Special Investigation Team. Remember, this is the first time that Riya has in fact been summoned and yesterday also the CBI questioned her brother Shaukat. Neha is joining us for more details. Neha, what can you tell us about the latest developments?
Absolutely, and we tell you that now it's almost been 3 hours since Riya Chakraborty has been called at the DRDO quarters for questioning by the CBI. Remember, the CBI had summoned her today for the questioning, and also we understand that she is the second member from the Chakraborty family to have been called by the CBI for summons. It's almost been 3 hours. Remember, there was a lot of drama that was created earlier in the day when she had left her house and she was on the way here to the DRDO quarters for questioning. The line of questioning definitely is very clear. It will be definitely about how both of them knew each other, which includes Riya and Sushant Singh Rajput. For how long has Riya been associated with Sushant Singh Rajput? And the fact that even Shaukat Chakraborty is present inside, the questioning will be related to the fact that what exactly also happened on 13th and 14th night. Let's also tell our viewers who all are present inside and are being questioned right now. There is Neeraj Singh, the former cook of Sushant Singh Rajput. There's Siddharth Patani, the former creative manager. There's also, we understand, Samuel Miranda, who was also, he was associated with both Riya and Sushant Singh Rajput. And these all people are present inside and their questioning is ongoing currently. And which is why, along with Riya, the questioning is likely to be at different stages here. We understand that SP Nupur Prasad herself will be questioning Riya, and the line of questioning will be very particularly related to the case, and also what exactly does she know about mental health here? Because let's also tell our viewers that how in the previous week CBI has not just been to the Cooper Hospital but also to the Waterstone Resort, where Riya had gone along with Sushant for taking treatment, spiritual treatment for his mental health. At the same time, CBI has been trying to talk to the doctors who conducted post-mortem on Sushant Singh Rajput and collecting their required evidence. So all all of this questioning is going to happen today. We also understand that today will also be the day when the forensic team that is accompanying CBI will be giving their report on what they have gathered from the evidence. Because remember, the AIIMS team in Delhi has been helping them with their forensic investigation. So even that is expected today. And on those questioning, on those lines also, the questioning will happen. But importantly, how long will Riya continue to remain inside will also be interesting to see, because we've seen CBI calling at least the different players in this case, which include Neeraj and Siddharth, for at least 6 to 7 times now. And now that Riya has been here for about 2 to 3 hours, we have to see how long will she be questioned.
All right, Neha, thank you so much for joining us with all of those details. Meanwhile, Mirunal has accessed the inside details of the line of investigation of the Narcotics Control Bureau. NCB is not just focusing on the drug angle in the Sushant case, but aiming to expose a much deeper drug angle and the drug cartels in Mumbai. A team from Mumbai Narcotics Bureau is already camping in Goa looking for alleged drug dealer Gaurav Arya. Listen in to Gaurav's lawyer.
Message that chat, the alleged chat that they are showing, is of March 2017. And Mr. Singh met with his unfortunate death in June 2020. So there seems to be no relation at all. So I see no truth, not a shred of truth in these allegations. I completely deny all these allegations. Every kind of cooperation, he will be forthcoming. He will join probe. He will answer all the questions. There is no question of him hiding. There is no question of him not answering and not joining. So there is full cooperation on the part of my client with any agency, whenever they want, wherever they want.
In fact, let me go across to Alok, who's joining us for more details. Alok, if you can take us through the larger issue that the NCB is going to be looking at.
Well, Avni, Narcotics Control Bureau has already started their investigation. And in fact, they may issue summon to Riya Chakravarti and other persons with whom she was in touch and talking about the drug deal. But if you see that there are a larger picture about this whole investigation, because Narcotics Control Bureau got this investigation after ED found out that there was the conversation that happening between Riya Chakravarti and her close associates. But there is one name who is identified as Gaurav Arya, and he is the Delhi-based businessman, but he is having the properties in Mumbai and Goa as well. In fact, in the month of March 2017, Riha if you see the chat, is writing about that she wants some drug, that is MDMA, from this person. And that is why the role of this person is need to be investigated, because this person is the first person whose name has just recently cropped up in the drug case. But earlier there were people who are already been named in the FIR. They are already been in fact questioned. So definitely his role need to be investigated. And the what the NCB sources are telling us that there may be a large number of raids may be conducted in the Mumbai and Goa as well in the coming days, because they are believing that there is a large network of drug cartel is working in Mumbai and Goa. And we all know that in the rave parties, whether it's Mumbai based rave parties or it's Goa based rave parties, several of these kinds of drugs are served. So this is the big network that is now going to be busted, and that's on that Narcotics Control Bureau is working on. Back to you.
All right, Alok, thank you so much for joining us with all of those details. On that note, we're going to slip into a very quick break, but more news on the other side. And this is news that's just coming in. News agency Reuters has reported that Shinzo Abe has resigned as Japan's prime minister, citing worsening health conditions. Those are the details coming in now. Shinzo Abe resigning as Japan's prime minister. And essentially the reason behind that is his worsening health conditions. And more news that's coming in. Jammu and Kashmir police have recovered the bullet-riddled body of BJP Panchayat member Nisar Ahmed Bhatt, who had been missing for the past 10 days. Body was recovered from an orchard in Jammu and Kashmir's Shopian district and cops were alerted. Further investigations are underway. Remember, 5 BJP punches have been killed in Kashmir over the past 2 months. Fareed is joining us for more details. Fareed, of course, there was, a member was missing for the last 10 days and there were speculations regarding what had happened, but his body has now been discovered.
Yes, you're absolutely right. Since the search was on for him, in between, if you remember, there was an audio message that had gone viral, apparently from militants who had claimed that they had abducted him and also at the same time said that he has been killed. The police at that time said that they were trying to authenticate this video, check its veracity. But it was quite clear that since there was no, absolutely no clue of him, since that audio message was correct. Now, today, early morning from Dangam village of Shopian, locals noticed a dead body in an orchard area, and immediately the police was called in. The police came in, the body has been retrieved. Formalities, medical legal formalities are being done, but now they've confirmed to us that yes, he is Nisar Ahmed Bhatt, a punch of the BJP from outskirts of Srinagar, from the Khanmu area, from who had gone to Shopian 10 days back and was abducted by militants. He has been killed, as you rightly said. It's been a spate of attacks against panchayat representatives of the BJP, grassroots workers, and also we know that an ex-district president was also killed. So there was this systematic attack against the BJP. Their workers were targeted across the length and breadth of the Kashmir Valley, and that obviously has led to a reign of fear in the rank and file of the BJP. That obviously is something that is expected. We've seen many resignations coming post that as well, and that's spate of resignations is still continuing. So it's a major challenge for the BJP leadership and also for the police to instill confidence in the BJP cadre, because now this fresh incident and this body being recovered is going to really take that fear to the next level. So a big challenge, but yes, targeting of BJP grassroots workers and its cadre in the Kashmir Valley continues. Though the police says that they have drawn a mechanism some time back, many BJP leaders and grassroots workers from vulnerable pockets across the Kashmir Valley were taken to safe houses, but that was a temporary plan. Since they have got back, so it is a massive challenge without a doubt to secure them. But yes, this latest incident is definitely going to really increase that fear and also the magnitude of challenge for the security agencies. Back to you.
Right. All right, Fareed, thank you so much for joining us with all of those details. All right, let's now turn our attention the latest as far as the latest phase of unlocking is concerned. We now spoke to Dr. Sarandeep Guleria, director of AIIMS and one of the leading experts fighting against the coronavirus. We specifically spoke to him on the post-COVID care and the risk of reinfection and whether there was a concern of the virus spreading in the upcoming festive season. Meanwhile, after 6 months into the pandemic, many patients feel the residual effects of the virus, which leads to the growing need for post-COVID care. Dr. Guleria said that many patients need some degree of medication even after being discharged from the hospital, and even the government needs to come up with strategies on how to deal with this.
The recovery rate of India has gone past 75%. At the same time, there are some cases where the patients have been coming back to hospital with some kind of anomaly. There is a post-COVID care that is required. To talk on this and many more things, we have AIIMS director, Dr. Randeep Guleria. Sir, thank you very much for your time. Sir, this is a new phenomenon that we are witnessing right now, the post-COVID care. Can you explain what is this? How many of the patients we are getting? AIIMS also has a center for that. What is the kind of response that you are seeing in this?
So in the beginning, we were concerned about managing COVID and the acute part of COVID and trying to save lives and prevent the spread of the infection. But now after 6 months, we're realizing that many patients have what we call residual effects of COVID. They can be very mild, like fatigue, body aches, lethargy. And many patients say that they recovered from COVID in June, July. But even now they feel tired, they are not able to work, they're not able to concentrate. So that is a post-COVID myalgias and a post-viral effect. But there are some patients who have more serious effects, because COVID, as we know, affects many organs. It can cause damage in the lungs, which can be significant, and therefore these patients need, after recovering, some degree of rehabilitation, some medicines, some degree of other support. Some have COVID affects the heart, their cardiac function comes down and they get breathless on mild activity, they get out of breath. Some need oxygen at home. So now we have to develop strategies of how do we manage these patients in the long term, and how can we improve their quality of life. So the government has actually is now setting up what we call a clinical trials registry, where we will follow up. First, we will have a registry for all COVID patients, so that we know how is the COVID presentation in our country, is it different from other countries. At the same time, this registry will also follow up patients to see how many of them develop post-COVID sequelae, and the follow-up will be for about 1 year, and therefore we will get more data as to what is the percentage and how, what is the different types of sequelae that we see.
We have been seeing this sero survey. Every state is conducting it. In fact, Delhi has done twice and third one is in process. Sir, how long does the antibody last in a person's body? And we have seen cases in Hong Kong and in Telangana, the minister accepted that there is a case of recurrence of COVID. How challenging is this and how do you see this? Has any incident reported to you in AIIMS about that?
So this is again something that we need to find out. One is antibodies are formed, but we do know that antibody formation varies from individual to individual. There are studies which suggest that in some people there are very good antibody response. In others, the antibody formation is not that high and therefore their protection is less. How long this antibody response lasts is not clear. It is very important because it has a bearing on the vaccine itself. And we need to follow up all our patients to see how long does this antibody response last.
And with that, it's a wrap on this edition. Thanks for watching. Stay tuned tomorrow.